Yes, yep, we can. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So this is the work that I'll be speaking about today. It's titled Phoneme Recognition Through Fine-Tuning of Phonetic Representation, and it's like a case study on Luhya dialects. Like Bukusu has already mentioned, this is work that I've done as part of a summer internship in collaboration with a couple of wonderful folks from Georgia, from Carnegie Mellon, George Mason University, and the University of Missouri. So we have Shinjan, Antonis, David, Michael, and Graham Ubig. And I will speak a little bit about the involvement of all these people a little later. My apologies if you hear breathing noises. My machine is breathing. It's preparing for takeoff. So a bit of an introduction of myself. So my background is in math and computer science. That's what I studied for my undergrad. And during this time, I was heavily involved with developer communities. And then after school, I went into a role as a data scientist at a company working in the telco space. Again, I got very heavily involved with AI and ML communities, largely because just from my campus experience, this was a way in which I guess I had learned to learn. So in an effort to gain data science skills on the job, I seeked out a learning community, and this is how I ended up being involved with first the Nairobi Women in Machine Learning and Data Science community, and then now I'm part of the Deep Learning Endeavor committee. I'm currently a master's student at Georgia Tech. I'm doing an online master's in computer science, and my specialization is computational perception and robotics. I'm also regional coordinator of the AI4D initiative. We have a bunch of work in very diverse areas. We find some work in policy, some work in capacity building, and finally in innovation. And under innovation, I'm particularly excited that we've been able to do a lot of work in language and speech processing, to fund a lot of work in language and speech processing. So that's been one of the highlights of being in this role for me. And I am interested in language and speech processing, particularly for African languages. So yeah, this work is part of a summer internship that I did with the new lab folks at CMU. Okay, so I'm going to do a bit of an introduction to speech recognition, and my definition straight out of Wikipedia is that basically automatic speech recognition is an interdisciplinary field combining computer science and computational linguistics. And it develops methodologies and technologies to enable the recognition and translation of spoken language into text by computers. Going into a couple of current trends. So like in many other fields of AI, at the moment we're seeing a lot of pre-training in aid of particularly low-resource speech processing. I'm going to list a couple of papers for reference. We have this work by Waisnett et al., and they explore pre-training by back translation for end-to-end ASR. And if you're familiar with back translation from machine translation, basically they are creating synthetic data to augment available data. And in this particular case, they use a text-to-text system. Further text-to-text encoder, and then with textual data, they generate synthetic speech features, which are then used to retain a decoder that is used in the ASR task of interest. There's also interesting research involving use of ASR as an auxiliary task to improving other low-resource improve low-resource speech-to-text translation. So particularly this work by Bansal et al., I find it very interesting because they use the low resource task in this experimental setting is Spanish, and they're looking to do Spanish to English speech translation. So they use about 300 hours of English ASR data to train a model. And very interestingly, they find that the encoder, which is the acoustic model, accounts for most of the improvements. Even though I think the expectation would have been that because the target language is English, and that's the because the target language is English, and that's the language in the pre-trained, in the auxiliary task.
Hey, Kathleen. Oh, sorry. There's just been a lot of people who've asked for your voice to be raised up a bit.
Okay. I'm not sure how to do that. Is this better? Shout out to my computer, James says. okay, I will try.
I don't know if you have multiple microphones or so. A bit of a people are like just saying as well.
Okay, I will put off my headphones and use my computer microphone, and let's see if that helps.
Okay.
So just give me a second to disconnect. Is this better? Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but let's see how it goes. Yeah.
Okay, let me know if it's better. Okay.
Yeah.
It looks like it might be better. Okay, so with this work by Bansal et al., let me just collect myself. They're looking to do Spanish to English speech translation, and then they use 300 hours of English ASR data to pre-train the model. And then interestingly, they find that it's the acoustic model that accounts for most of the improvements as opposed to the language model, with the expectation having been that the shared language would lead to a lot of the improvement. So having identified that, they also do some pre-training on ASR, where the ASR task is completely different from both the source and target languages in the speech translation task, and find that that also leads to great improvements. And while this insight makes it seem like a carte blanche to do as much multilingual pre-training as possible in aid of your low-resource speech recognition task, it's actually not as simple as that, because effective multilingual learning of acoustic and language models is actually still a very difficult task, given particularly the underlying differences between languages in pronunciation and in the lexicon. So the work that we did with my summer is heavily reliant on this work by Lee et al. And you'll see that Shinjan was also one of our collaborators in this work. And it highlights the fact that there are issues with traditional multilingual ASR learning, because a lot of it ignores the underlying phonetic representations and only relies on the language specific phonemes. So they propose a model that calculates a language universal phoneme distribution using a standard ASR encoder and converts it to a language specific phoneme distribution. So a bit of definitions. A phoneme is a sound that can support lexical contrasts in a particular language, and these are language specific. Sorry. And then a phone is a sound, is the sound that is actually spoken, which are language dependent. So at the end of the day, orthographies of languages vary, but then the sound that actually is produced can be similar or be different, I guess, depending on the languages. Then looking at traditional ASR models, there's two main groups that it can be divided into. And then I'm going to be doing a comparison with the Allosaurus model, which is the one that we actually use in this work. So it can be divided into two main groups. The first is one with a shared phoneme model, which predicts phoneme distributions over a shared phoneme inventory. And that's what we have here. So there's a shared encoder, and then there's shared phonemes. And then in the second one, we have private phoneme models, where each language has its own phoneme inventory, but then there is a shared encoder. And then the Allosaurus model, which is what we use, presents improvements, because basically the allophone layer allows us to pay attention to the concept of phonology and how different phones translate to phonemes in particular or individual languages. So the ignorance of phonology is an issue because in reality, two words may share a phoneme but are different in the actualized, in the actual phonetic realization. And on the left, I have this image where the words are at the top. And you see, for example, with English speak and peak, they have the same phonemes within the language, but then the realization, which is the phones, are quite different. And if we compare this to Mandarin Chinese, Ping and Bing, they have different phonemes within the language, but then these phonemes again subsequently translate to different phones. So if we did a multilingual training task with both English and Chinese data in the pre-training and ignored the knowledge of phonology, then it's an oversimplification because this phone difference and its translation to the phoneme of English, that's completely ignored. So it's a bit of an oversimplistic view. So then enter Allosaurus, and it's a multilingual pre-trained phoneme recognition model, which predicts over a shared phone inventory, which is our universal phone layer over here, and then maps into language-specific phonemes with an allophone layer. So the allophone layer in particular incorporates knowledge of phonology into the multilingual model and associates a universal narrow phone set with the phonemes that appear in the transcription of each language. So moving into a bit of a description of the Luhya language varieties, which are the languages that I was working in. So Luhya languages are spoken in both Western Kenya and Eastern Uganda, and they are a cluster of approximately 25 Bantu languages. However, Luhya in particular typically refers to about 19 Kenyan communities that were politically united in the first half of the 20th century. And I keep using approximately because really the number varies depending on what source, and it's probably one of those things which was just not properly recorded from the start, so we will possibly never know. But then together, the Kenyan Luhya communities number around 6.8 million, and it is the second largest ethnic group in Kenya. There are two languages that we used in this work. That's Bukusu and Saamia. The Bukusu are the largest Kenyan Luhya community with more than 1 million members. And then there are more than 85,000 members of the Saamia community in Kenya, and then another 279 located in Uganda. Recent classification of Luhya languages shows that despite their diversity, there are language varieties that are more closely related to one another than the nearest Bantu neighbors in the West and in the East. So at this point, I guess I'll mention that within the Luhya communities, there are some dialects that are more mutually intelligible than others. And okay, let me step away from saying dialects. I'm just going to say language variety. But then there are some that are more mutually intelligible than others. And then there are some which are as different as, I don't know, being a completely other language. So there's also a long-running debate about whether they should be considered dialects or languages. And there's some research which you can go read up on to understand more about that. And Agongo et al. Do a study of mutual intelligibility of Kenyan Luhya varieties. I'm going to include links to this. I realize I forgot to do that. So moving into access of data and preparation. So for Saamia, we got 20 hours of sentence length audios and transcriptions from the CMU Wilderness Multilingual Speech Datasets, which covers over 700 languages. These are readings of Bible data. And the GitHub repo of CMU Wilderness provides code to scrape the data from the website. And then there's alignments which you can reconstruct from packed versions that are contained in the GitHub repo. So that was the process of preparing the Saamia data. Bukusu was a little different. So one of our collaborators is a linguist. And I think we were very lucky to have gotten in touch with him and found him willing to share the data that he's been creating. So he has an ongoing documentation project on several Luhya language varieties, and he provided recordings from his unpublished dictionary. during my time, we were able to prepare the data for Bukusu and use that. But then he did make available data for two other Luhya languages, so Tiriki and Wanga. In the case of this data, I will say it's not ideal, or it was not ideal for speech recognition task, because he was creating the data for his linguistic purposes. So each recording contained two or more pronunciations of the same word. If it was a noun, it would be the singular and plural form of the word. In the case that it was a verb, it might have been the infinitive form of the verb with one or two conjugated forms of the verb. So it really varied from recording to recording. And the preparation process was particularly time consuming because of that. So that process included having to change the sampling rate, in some cases to change the sampling encoding. And this was just so that we could use our voice activity detection tool to split the audio at points of silence, after which I needed to manually inspect the result of all the segmentations and then align the transcriptions as necessary. So figure out which ones are the singular ones and align them with their transcriptions and the plural ones and the various conjugated forms of the verbs. We also needed to develop an orthography to phone mapping for the two languages. So again, it was really great to have worked with linguists on this work, because they were able to weigh in a lot in that capacity. The Bukusu transcriptions were already in IPA, because that's the form in which the linguist had created them in. And then for the Saamia mapping, it enabled us to do transcription of our data using Epitrans. So in the case of Saamia, we had the actual transcription, like the orthography, and we converted that into IPA. And at this point, I will mention that a challenge experienced in low-resource speech recognition is just lack of a standard orthography. So even with Luhya dialects, you'll find that native speakers differ on how writing of some words or phones and phonemes should be, just because they've spoken these languages and maybe not used them in school or in formal settings where you're taught, okay, this is how you write this word. So learning the phonemes is without a standardization of the orthography, that's a challenge. And that's why we chose to use IPA, because at the end of the day, the realization of a sound is unique. And I mean, the IPA itself is a universal standard, so that's easy to work with. Moving into the experiments. So we're working with a pre-trained acoustic model, which is our encoder over here. And we have this universal phone recognizer, which is based on universal phone representations. And what we're interested in understanding is exactly how much data leads to improvements in model performance via fine-tuning. We created training sets of different sizes. For the Saamia data, we had about 7,000 audios, and for the Bukusu data, we had 6,000 audios. So we created training sets of different sizes, 10, 25, 50, 100, 250, 500, 1,000, 2,500, 5,000. And this selection of training set sizes is intended to be in an approximately doubling progression. And then we evaluate using the phone error rates on the fine-tuning language test sets. All training sets use the same encoder. So it's a six-layer stacked bidirectional LSTM with a hidden size of 1024 in each layer. And then in each instance, fine-tuning was carried out for 250 epochs, beyond which there was no significant variation. We used a learning rate of 0.01 to avoid catastrophic forgetting. And then we used stochastic gradient descent as the optimization algorithm. Moving into results. So the first row over here is results of zero-shot inference using the pre-trained Allosaurus model. We found this to be fairly good right off the bat. And then the second row is results when the allophone layer is constrained to phones found in the respective languages. So improvement at that point was already very great, which is why the basis of this work was just to see how much better we could get the model to perform with fine-tuning. And then the best results after fine tuning on the data set of 100, 1,000 are shown. And then finally on the entirety of the data in each case. And for Saamia, which was performing particularly well, by the time we have 100, a test set of size 100, we have an increase of 58% relative to the language constraint baseline, which leads us to conclude that even with just 100 utterances, we can get significant improvements in phone error recognition, which is pretty epic. In this figure, we show the data set sizes of phone error rates, curving phone error rate curves at training epoch 100 for both Saamia and Bukusu. As expected, the phone error rate decreases as the data set sizes increase. And that's particularly evident for Saamia, which is our red curve over there. In the case of Bukusu, we do note that the 10 and 100 data set size PERs are somewhat consistent, presenting few improvements over zero shot results. So we concluded that this result or this discrepancy is likely due to the nature of data. And if you remember the description of the Bukusu data, which is the one we got access from the linguist, in the 10 sized data set or in the 100 sized test set, we can conclude that that's literally 10 words or 100 words. So it's actually very little data, which is why we really don't see any improvements to start with, or rather beyond the zero shot results. This curves show accuracy of our training epochs for a number of data set sizes. We have 10, 100, 1,000, and 5,000. Again, across both varieties, fine-tuning quickly improves the phone error rate after a few epochs. And we note that with the smaller fine-tuning data sets of just 10 and 100, particularly for Bukusu, and you'll see that over here, they only require a single fine-tuning epoch to reach their best performance. Again, likely because of the size of data, but then we note that 100 is not much better than 10. So moving into future work, it would be interesting to experiment with tuning the parameters of the Allosaurus model itself, as opposed to just fine-tuning the model, or more sophisticated training techniques such as adaptation layer by layer adaptation of the encoder or allophone layers. Also, as some languages are more closely related than others within the Luhya varieties, it might be interesting to experiment with further fine-tuning on multiple languages from the language group, also particularly because we do have the data. Also, as Luhya languages are tonal, something else we're considering is pre-training Allosaurus with a couple of tonal languages and then performing tonal recognition to see how that goes. And finally, it would be of great utility to incorporate similar techniques into a fully fledged speech recognition system, because we chose to focus on phoneme recognition at this point. So yeah, I am at the end of the presentation, which took half an hour in proof of the fact that I can't just talk and talk and talk. I'm sorry, I hope the audio was audible. I can see mentions of my computer and the fact that it is breathing. I apologize.
thanks a lot, Kathleen, for the presentation. I would like to open it up for any questions. I think it's very okay. So I guess the first question comes from Jade. What would it take to extend this work to a fully fledged ASR?
A lot more data, I will say, and we'd need to look into standardizing an orthography, I think. So we need to move from doing just phone recognition to training an acoustic model and a language model. But then I think essentially we need a lot more data and to engage linguists in creating a grapheme, a G2P mapping, so a grapheme to phoneme mapping, because again, we've done an orthography to phone mapping, and that's a little different. So I think to get an, what is a grapheme? I was looking this up yesterday, and I will actually just Google because I don't remember. It's a smallest meaningful conservative unit of a writing system. Basically, it's a phoneme. So an orthography to phone mapping is going from, I might be confused. Yeah, a grapheme is a phoneme, and we are working with phones. Jade, I'd have to do a bit more Googling to answer your question, to be honest.
All right, thanks. There was a question. Oh, sorry, your hand up. Oh, okay, we've got no. Who was somebody who has had their hand up before the two currently? Oh, Michael. Michael Nana, you can go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Kathleen, for this wonderful presentation. I would like her to emphasize on, sorry for the quality of my English.
No, don't apologize for that. Go ahead, ask the question.
I would like her to emphasize on the way she treats raw data into digital ones. Because when you record voice, because she said the voice was the second procedure, she had voice recorded. I would like how do you proceed to transform raw data, recording voice, into digital ones? And the second one, I would like you to emphasize, to highlight how a bit the architecture of the procedure you follow to achieve the results. Thank you.
Have you okay. I think so. Okay. So you're, so in the first instance, how do we convert voice data to digital formats?
Yes.
And then your second question is, what is your second question?
Could you describe the architecture you follow to achieve the result?
Okay.
Thank you.
So getting the voice to digital formats, we started with audios, and each audio is accompanied by a transcription. So that means that whatever is contained in the audio recording is written down. Again, because we do phoneme recognition, we don't have a transcription in the English that you would read. The transcription is in IPA. And maybe at this point I can go back to one of my slides, this slide. So we didn't have transcriptions in that you could take it and see that the word spoken in this audio is speak or the word spoken in this audio is speak. We were working with IPA, so we were working with phones. And this means that the transcriptions were accompanied by representations that linguists use to understand sound. So it wasn't so much something that could be read, but then it was a description of sound. And IPA is based on, I guess, the different places that you vocalize the different places that you vocalize sound from. So vowels are pronounced someplace, and then the sounds which are pronounced like at the throat or a little lower in the voice box, and the sounds which you pronounce with like your tongue to your tooth. And I'm really not a linguist, but then linguists have a universal system for understanding sound based on what vocal features or what, yeah, vocal features you use to pronounce them. So we had audios and then transcriptions, which are descriptions essentially of where the sounds are produced. And with that, yeah, essentially that was our data. Our encoder was learning acoustic features, which means paying attention to the acoustic features. I may be completely lost and freaking out. But yeah, basically that was our data preparation, and it went into fine tuning. Because the model was pre-trained, the fine tuning was, I'm completely freaking out. I'm going to stop answering the question there.
Yeah, sorry, okay.
And then I'm gonna keep going. The architecture to achieve the results. Again, gonna go back to this, and we have Allosaurus. So this encoder is an LSTM system. If we want to go into the details, it's 6 layered. Each layer was 1024. Neurons, and then we have this universal phone layer, and then the allophone layer, which incorporates knowledge of phonology into the system.
Okay, thanks. There's a question from Seko. I'll just switch between people asking. So Seko says, how did this project start, and what was the role of the Indaba in the creation and performance of this research?
How did this project start? Well, I've been interested in languages for a while. I'll say a couple of years, since my time working in the telco company where I worked, and realizing some challenges. So we would handle SMS data, and that was quite stressful, particularly in election years, because post-election violence is a feature of election years in Kenya.